Welcome to Webcast Wednesday. Today's webcast is Complex Shapes and Surfaces for Beginners, and Stephen White is your presenter.
Thanks, Nick. Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. So, as Nick says, today's webcast on complex shapes and surfaces for beginners. And firstly, we'll just go through a quick agenda just to make sure that we know what's going to be happening. Just need to be presenter. Perfect, so hopefully everyone can see my screen now. So first of all, we'll just go through a quick introduction, just what we're going to cover today. And the other points are the main bits, topics that we're going to cover. So today we'll be looking at complex shape creation, but it's really just an introduction to complex shape creation. So looking at some of the tools to create sweeps, lofts and boundaries. We'll also have a quick look at the differences between solids and surfaces and why one might choose one over the other. And finally, we'll look at something called hybrid modeling techniques, which are kind of a mix of solid and surface modeling. And this webcast is really aimed at those users that haven't sat on the advanced part of surface modeling course, just to give you a quick overview. Any questions, and obviously we just ask them at the end. So first of all, we'll start with solids and surfaces. So most of you probably know that we can model with both within SolidWorks, so solids and surfaces. Most of the essential course is all solids, and surfacing really isn't touched upon until the surface modeling course. The thing about solid and surface modeling is they're pretty much identical. The only difference mainly is how we define what an edge is. So within a solid body, we can define an edge as a boundary between two faces. So within this cube example at the top right, the red line represents an edge which connects two faces of the model. In a surface body, an edge is not connected between two faces, although technically it can be, but it's normally a boundary around a surface. So on the left-hand example here, the red line represents an edge, which is the boundary of a surface. A surface within SolidWorks has no thickness, whereas a solid has some sort of volume. What SolidWorks actually does in the background is generate surfaces and join them together to form solids. So none of the geometry actually creating in SolidWorks is truly just solid geometry. It's or does all the surfacing in the background for your convenience. So let's have a quick look at how we create surfaces. I'll just do a quick comparison between solid geometry and surface geometry just to give you an idea for the key differences. So first of all, we'll just create a cube. Just grab up a solid geometry. It's obviously a standard extrude and it has a volume inside of it, so it's a solid piece of geometry. For surfacing, there's a unique toolbar for surfaces where we can perform our standard surfacing commands. They're pretty much exactly the same as solids, that they only generate surface geometry. Pretty straightforward. So same tools, we just grab up a surface, but this time it'll only create the faces of our shell, so there's no internal volume to it. Just to make things a bit easier, we can cap the ends on the top, and then we can just fill in the bottom with another surfacing tool. So we're essentially creating the same geometry, but the left-hand side has an internal volume, and the right-hand side has no internal volume. For all intents and purposes, they're the same shape, same geometry, just one solid and one surface. What we can then do is switch between the two, so we can convert a solid to a surface, and we can convert a surface to a solid, just by joining the surfaces and forming a solid, and that converts the surface back to solid geometry. So they're interchangeable, we can go backwards and forwards between one and the other, and it makes it a really flexible way of working, and we'll look at that when we get to the end with our hybrid modeling technique. What you'll probably notice is that surface modeling can be a little bit longer, can take a little bit longer to get to the final result. Instead of just creating a cube, I had to create a couple of features and then knit them together. And they're the commands we use to get to them. So you might ask me why we bother surface modeling when we can create solid geometry a lot quicker, or a lot more efficiently. Well, that's not always the case. There's a few reasons we might want to create surface geometry instead of solid geometry. And a lot of it comes down to complexity of the model. So solid features normally create geometry that's a little bit more simplified, and normally one of the sides of the model is flat when we create a solid. So we normally create surface geometry to cap off flat ends with organic geometry, or to create geometry from this offset that doesn't have any flat ends. Surface modeling also gives us a lot more flexibility when we're building, because we can choose to model just individual faces. When we create a solid, we obviously get a solid block, so some of the faces might not be relevant. They might not need them to create the final shape. And that obviously means we have to remove that geometry, creating more features in the tree. With surfaces, we can choose which surface or which face we need to create, so we can be a lot more selective with the geometry we're creating. Surfaces can also be reference geometry. So we can use just revolves, extrudes, and so on, like we just showed with the cube. And we can all use that in the modeling technique to help us create solid geometry. And also, although surface geometry can sometimes take a lot longer, it can also be a lot more efficient. If we're creating only the faces we need, the feature tree can be a lot smaller, as we don't need to start deleting out faces, knitting and merging back solid geometry. But it really depends on the geometry we're creating and the tools that we're used to using. Okay, so what we'll look at first is complex geometry in terms of solid features, and there'll be three features we'll use. We'll use the sweep, we'll use the loft, and we'll use the boundary. Now the sweep is kind of a simplified version of the loft and boundary tool. They're actually very similar tools, just the kind of have different applications, which we'll get into in a moment. We'll start with the sweep. Most of you probably have used the sweep if you've sat on the Essentials course. The sweep tools on the Features tab, swept boss base. And what we allow to select in here is a profile and a path, and that's pretty much it. There is the option for guide curves, but that's more of a kind of an advanced tool. The first thing we'll choose is our profile, which will be our ellipse. Then we choose our path, which is our curve, and we get a nice preview. So it takes the path, the profile, and sends it along the path. Now along the way, we can control the orientation of the path and or the profile and how it twists. There's quite a few different options. So we can start to control maybe how much it turns, so we can have it twist along the path, either with turns or degrees. That helps to create some quite peculiar looking geometry very quickly. I mentioned before that we can create guide curves. So guide curves help to control the shape. That's something that we'll cover in the advanced topics on complex modeling. But it's a good way to kind of control the shape of geometry. And we can also control whether we have a thin feature, so if we wanted to maybe create a hollow section along our path. That's essentially all we can do with a sweep. So we take a single profile and a single path, and the profile travels along the path and creates our final geometry. So just create a quick little handle there. What happens if we want to vary the shape a little bit more, maybe change the oval to a circle or to a square as it travels along this path? Well, that's something we can't do with a sweep, so we'll have to go and look at maybe a loft to do that kind of geometry change. Okay, just to save a bit of time, I've modelled up some sketches already. So everything in SolidWorks relies on a sketch. So for our loft sections, we just created four sketches. The first one's just the half of the top view. Sketch 2 is the right-hand view. Sketch 3 is just a duplication, a derived sketch of sketch 1. And sketch 5 is just the bottom profile. So we're essentially creating all of the standard views, and then we're going to create a nice organic shape in between all of those. Now the loft tool has a few more options to kind of get your head around. A lot of them you'll hopefully never have to tweak. It'll hopefully be a good first time, but it's good to go through them. First of all, on the profile selection, there's something called a selection manager. So especially when we've got lots of sketches going on, it can be quite difficult to pick exactly what we want. So the selection manager is aimed to help that. There's a few different options. Closed loops. Now this is probably the best one to use when we're creating solid loft geometry. So what the closed loop tool will do if you see it highlighted in orange here, I've got a closed loop. It'll select all of the closed geometry sketch lines that we need to create a closed loop. And that's all we really need to do. The other options, just to go through them, open loop. It will select any open loops. All of mine are closed, so it's not going to select any. There's then select group. And this is quite flexible because we can actually be very specific about the areas we want. So we can go around and pick the group that's made up of two lines in my case, and create our own closed group out of a subset of a sketch geometry. And then finally, as a region, which kind of uses the closed loop tool to identify a region, so we can quickly go and pick an area, and it just highlights in pink so we know exactly what we're picking. So as I say, for solid geometry, closed loop's the best tool to use because it ensures that we're actually going to be able to create a solid successfully. And when we pick it, we can then confirm the selection and hit OK. And as we select it, you'll see it starts to show as a preview. Now what the loft's doing is it's taking our sketch, and then it's taking our second sketch, and it's creating geometry between them. Now if we have two profiles, it just creates a straight loft from one to the other, so just a straight line. Just draw that on the screen. That's obviously just because we've already selected two sketches. If we start to select more, so if I add another section in, what it's going to start to do is actually create an organic transition between the three profiles. So instead of a straight line from one to the other and around, it's just going to create a nice spline around them. And as we repeat that process, in our selection manager, we can quickly get our final shape. Now, obviously, we can't reselect the first profile, because that'll just deselect it from our box on the left. So on the left-hand side, there's a closed loft. This makes sure that the final section and the first section meet back up with one another. So we create a nice organic shape. Now, with lofts, we can sometimes get a little bit confused with connectors. So these little green dots that you'll see on the screen, one at one end and one at the other, they help drive how the profile connects from one profile to the other. And it's normally an issue generated with the areas that we pick on our sketch. So ideally, we need these two green dots to line up. The easiest way to make sure that they line up is just to drag one to the other, and that makes sure that they all update. There we go. And then we get a preview. No preview, no model. If we get a preview, then we're happy it's going to be generating some solid geometry. So that's our preview. There's a few options within Loft, so we can have guide curves again to help control the shape. It's more of an advanced technique. Unique to the loft tool is centerline parameters, which lets us define a centerline between the profiles. It's a limitation of the boundary, which we'll come onto in a moment. We've then got merge tangent faces, which if we've got tangency in our sketch, it'll carry it through to the solid model, which is ideally nice. In our case, we've got splines, so we don't really need to merge those. Then there's preview if we want to, obviously want to preview. Thin feature again if we want to create a hollow model. And then if we want to, we can go into curvature display to start showing the surface that it's generating. So the surface in SolidWorks is a four-sided mesh. So it's called a UV mesh. So all surfaces are better represented with four sides rather than three. That's why we get a nice square preview. That just helps us show that the geometry we're creating is actually going to look good. So we've got zebra stripes and also curvature combs if we want to make sure that it's not looking too bad. Obviously at the moment it looks a little bit hairy, so we can reduce the number of curvature combs. Okay, so that's our lofted shape created just from our four sketches. So it's pretty easy to use. There's a few things that we can tweak to adjust the profile, but that's basically the loft tool. Okay, now the boundary tool is very, very similar. The boundary boss base is actually a newer tool than the loft, and it's probably preferred to the loft in most cases. There's a few cases where you'd probably have to use the loft, but most of the time I'd probably try and use the boundary first before going back to the loft. It works in the same way, so we've got our profiles that we select, and once again we've got close surface, which will help maintain a nice closed boundary. And the actual geometry in this case will be pretty much identical to the loft. It's using the same profile. Where the boundary becomes very useful is the ability to define more, have more control over the second direction or the guide curves that we're creating. And we'll go into a little bit more detail in some of the advanced webcasts. So regardless of how we're creating organic geometry, it always relies on creating our sketches first and then creating our solid geometry. So the importance is on the sketch. If we're creating solids, you need to make sure that it's closed. So I've just put a straight line in here to make sure it's a closed contour. Otherwise, it's not going to work when we're trying to create a solid piece of geometry. And the selection manager is always really useful using the closed loop just to make sure that we're selecting exactly what we need. So there's a few different options there, the sweep, the loft, and the boundary. People always ask which one's best to use. It really does depend on the geometry you're creating. So for the sweep, it only uses one profile. That profile can vary in size, which we can go into this afternoon. But a circle can't become a square, so the actual geometry shape can't vary. So a circle can't become a slot, and so on. So that's best for single profile and a path to define a direction. So a handle, a spring, some sort of crowbar, I guess, that would be a sweep. A loft allows us to do multiple profiles of different shapes, so square to rounds and so on, and they can be blended together. But we've got less control over intermediate profiles. So if we've got, in our case, we have four profiles, there's not as much control on the intermediate ones. We can only really control the start and finish profiles. And finally, the boundary. It's similar to loft, but we've got a lot more control over intermediate profiles as well as second direction profiles. So it gives us a lot more control and flexibility. So I'd probably start, if we're looking at a very organic shape, with a boundary. If a boundary is not working, try a loft. And if a loft's not working, we can break it down and do it in more kind of step-by-step process. So a loft for when a center line is required, or where there are few or no guide curves. So very few profiles and few guide curves, good for a loft. And then boundary, maximum control is required, and there's several curves in both directions, so we need a lot of control over the shape we're creating and a lot of accuracy. Okay. So what surface features do we have that we can compare to the solid features? Well, pretty much exactly the same, sweep, loft, and boundary. But as I mentioned at the start, we've got a lot more control over the faces that we're creating, so which surfaces we create one at a time. What I'll quickly go through, though, before then, is just the difference between a boundary and a loft. There's sometimes a little bit of confusion about when we'd use a loft over a boundary. So I've got an example here of a circle that goes to a rounded rectangle. And we'll do that with a boundary boss base. As I mentioned before, it's probably the best one to do. So we'll go from rectangle to round. And I'll just tweak these little green connectors just to make sure that everything doesn't twist too much. Obviously, it's gone straight from one profile to the other, as we'd expect, but we've got a guide curve here that we want to connect them, so it makes sense that we go into our direction 2 and select it. What we can't do in the boundary is actually not have the guide curve connected to the sketch geometry. So because this is in the center of each sketch, we actually can't use it for our boundary. There's no way to use that to drive the sketch. And that's just a limitation with the boundary. This sketch line here would actually have to be connected to the physical sketch geometry, the circle and the rectangle, to make things a little bit easier. So that's where our loft comes in. With our loft, we select the same profiles, but there's an extra parameter called center line where we can pick our line, make sure we're in the right tool. And that'll help to drive that geometry a lot easier. Just make sure that everything's lined up, and there we go. So if we've got a center line that drives the direction of the profiles, we have to use a loft, and that's one of the main times that people would have to go about using a loft over a boundary. Okay, so let's have a look at surfaces. Surfaces are generated in the same way as solids. This time we don't need to close the boundary, and we also have a little bit more control over which sub-segments we choose and so on in our selection manager. Tools are the same, so swept surface we'll start with. Choose our profile and path. This time I'll go into select group, it's probably the easiest one to use. And we just select our edges, and that's our sweep. Same options as before, we can twist it along the path if we want to. Start to create some wild geometry if we need to. That's our first surface created. We then move on to a loft. So this is all pre-prepared just to save a little bit of time. So lofted surface, same again, we just pick our individual lines that we need. Remember, we're actually just creating the outside edge of the model this time, so we're not worrying about the top face and the bottom face, we're just creating the overall profile around the edge. And I'll just add a guide curve in just to help control it. So that's our loft. So we've created our top surface and our sides. We then need to just create our underneath one. It's a bit more funky. And I use the boundary surface in this case. So same as before, we're just selecting the profiles and it's creating a spline between them. Just go to the side view. So what it's doing is it's taking one profile to the other and just creating a nice spline between them. Now obviously this spline might not be the one we want, so we can just add a guide curve in direction two, just to help drive it. And that's our surfaces. So we've created three individual surfaces that represent our geometry. What we then need to do is obviously remove the bits that we don't want, and there's a really nice tool called Trim Surface, which should do that job for us. We can pick all of our surfaces, and all we need to say is which bits we want to keep. So I'm going to keep the top, the side, and the bottom. It'll get rid of everything else and join it all together. And that kind of geometry, I'm not really going to be able to create using solid sweeps or solid lofts very quickly. Going to have a lot of time and a lot of guide curves in there. But if we can create surfaces individually, top, bottom, and sides, and then just join them together afterwards, it's going to save us a lot of time. So that's kind of an example of where surfaces would obviously be a better option than solids. Okay. So the trim and knit tools, which I just looked at the end, they bring the surfaces back to our solid geometry. So they trim everything back, knit everything together, and form our solids. And because we can switch between them two very easily, that's why we sometimes use something called hybrid modeling to help out with the geometry creation. So far we've looked at two separate modeling techniques, solids and surfaces, and we haven't really mixed the two together. But as I say, because they're so easy to swap between, we can actually just do both surface and solid modeling in one part file. To do that, we'll just open up this one here. We've got some surfaces pre-prepared, and these surfaces represent the top surface, bottom surfaces, and a kind of a tapered face on one side of the model. So what we're going to do is start to use solid geometry techniques now, but use the surfaces as guides or surfaces as kind of cutting tools to help create the geometry. So first thing we'll do is an extruded boss base just using this profile. Obviously we've got a depth for our model. But we might actually just want it to go up to this surface. So it's one of the end conditions, is up to surface. You might not really think of it as a hybrid modeling technique, but because we're using a surface body to terminate the solid body, it is hybrid modeling. So quite a nice way to get into the hybrid modeling technique. We'll just put draft on it as well, just to make it a little bit more interesting. There we go, so that's terminated the solid body where it meets our surface, so we've created a really nice smooth surface on top of our solid body. There's then a tool called Cut with Surface, and this means we can take this curved surface here and actually physically cut the solid model. We specify a direction for it to remove the material, and it'll just chop that off the bottom of our solid model. hide that out. And finally, another hybrid modeling technique is something called replace face, where we can take a face from a solid body, say this end face here, and we can take a surface body, this one here, and replace one with the other. So it essentially replaces our boring circular end face with a nice spline end face. So very quickly we can use those surfaces we were using as construction geometry to drive the shape of our solid body. No need to knit, no need to form a solid. We can just section through it just to make sure it's all solid. And there we go. And then obviously we can apply fillets and whatever we need to the model. So that's what we would call hybrid modeling, using surfaces and solids, mixing them together to get to a final solution quicker than either using solids or surfaces on their own. And that's probably the most efficient way to work, if you can get used to working with solids and surfaces mixed together, and it's quite a nice way to go. Okay, so that was quite a quick overview, really. What we'll do now is just pause for any questions, if anyone has any questions related to the kind of stuff we've shown or any other more advanced questions, then just shout out.
Okay, thanks Stephen, that was a really nice concise overview of complex shapes and surfaces. This afternoon at 3 o'clock we'll be doing complex shapes and surfaces for advanced users. So I think hopefully attending this webcast should at least qualify people. If you haven't done the sort of surfacing training course, you come along and join us for that session to learn a bit more about surfacing. We will be opening up to a Q&A session just now. We'll do that in just a second. If you do have to leave, thanks for attending this webcast. Thanks, Stephen, for a great overview there. And we look forward to speaking to you again this afternoon for the complex shapes and surfaces for advanced users.